So thank you so much for having me today. I'm really encouraged that this meeting exists and that I have the opportunity to speak to you all today. And what first comes to mind when I think about this conversation in terms of mobilizing and activating 22 million young voters in this really essential and pivotal 2020 campaign that is ahead of us, what first comes to mind is this word agency. When I think back to 2008, right, when Obama ran his first campaign, I was in fourth grade. And I was in fourth grade, and I got a Time Kids newsletter. And I read about the candidates, Cynthia McKinley, Barack Obama, and I went home and I researched them. And in fourth grade, Barack Obama made me believe that I could, right? Yes, we can, yes, we could, right? And I had a sense of agency that I couldn't vote. I was in fourth grade. I couldn't even close to vote, let alone read and be literate. But he made me believe that I had some sort of agency, that it didn't matter that I couldn't vote, that I had to do something to help him get elected. And I made my mom take me to his campaign office, and I got buttons on my backpack, and I had stickers, and I campaigned with my classmates, and we had this school-wide mock election, and I campaigned as fervently as I do now for real candidates, and for real campaigns, rather, right, within the country rather than my school. And I think about the agency that he made me feel like I had, that I could do something, and that's what I think that we need to center this conversation with. We need to center this conversation with a recognition that young people need to feel like our voice matters, like we can be heard, and like something's gonna happen as a result of being heard, and that we can play a role in that happening. And in order to do that, I think two things need to happen. We need to, one, be really critically thinking about how to excite young people. Right? I was in fourth grade, and a Time Kids newsletter excited me. Right? How can we replicate that excitement? Young people showed up in 2008, they showed up in 2012, they did not show up in 2016. Right? What are we doing wrong that is not enfranchising, that is not motivating and not activating young people? Why are we not excited? And secondly, young people need to be authentically and constantly engaged. I think that there's a lot of, okay, young people are important in theory, but very little actual groundwork happening to enfranchise and empower young people. And that's sort of the core message of my talk, right? The title of it is, if you think young people are indeed powerful, empower us. It really shouldn't be that complicated. And when you think of your organizations and the value that you're putting on young people, I want to ask you some questions. These are rhetorical by nature because I think I know most of the answers, but maybe I don't. But how many young people, right, are on your boards? And I think a lot of organizations that I'm seeing these days would say, oh, well, we have a young person, he's 37, you know, or we have a young person at 32. And that's a different generation than me. All right, I'm 18 years old, I just started college 3 weeks ago. I don't identify with a 37-year-old. That is not the 22 million voters that you're trying to reach. And if you're interested in empowering young people, if you're interested in 22 million people voting, then you have to empower us in real tangible ways, right? We should not just have board seats and have non-voting status. Like, we need to be really decision makers, right? We need to be sitting at the head of the table and sharing our perspectives. And the reason I brought friends today is because I'm not the only one who's articulate, right? I'm not the only one who knows a thing or two about politics, right? Everyone that I surround myself with is equally qualified to do all the same things that I've been so fortunate to be able to do. And I'm not an anomaly. There are so many young people, wherever you are, that have the capacity to really change the pulse of conversation in your boardrooms, have the capacity to change your committees, your strategic planning summits, and we need to be having the mic just as often as everyone else. Right? These decisions impact our future. And disproportionately impact our future. But as we think about this 2020 election, what's happening in this country right now, we and the children that we hope to one day have are really going to deal with a lot of the brunt of what's happening. And when you guys go to the polls, right, when people go to the polls, that needs to be the first thing on your mind when you're voting, right? Because the reason why I'm a progressive, right, the reason why I am active in politics is not because I necessarily am interested in my liberation or my rights, but because when I go to polls, I'm not thinking about who's the best president for me, I'm thinking about who's the best president for my country, right? Who's the best mayor for my town? And in that collective consciousness, right, it's not just about the 22 million voters making them vote, it's about making sure that those before those 22 million voters are voting with them in mind, right? Because we're going to be motivated to vote if we think that the people who are also voting with us care about us, right, and care about our future and are deeply invested in thinking about the power that we have in this nation and the repercussions of what's happening in this nation. And so I think that we should be having young people on board. But more than that, I'm sure that many of you probably get emails, cold emails from young people, right? You probably get asked questions from young people. Respond to them, engage them, invite them in, make them feel a sense of agency, like they matter, right? How many times in your work week are you having a non-small talk conversation with someone under the age of 21? Probably, I imagine, not very often, unless maybe you have kids. Right? And in which case, they're not necessarily talking about the tools and mechanisms to mobilize 22 million voters. But I imagine they have a lot to say on the issue, whether they know it or not. And that's sort of the foundation of a lot of my work. Because I founded an organization in eighth grade, Redefy, and what we are is we're a global nonprofit with nearly 500 students from around the world. And we are deeply interested in campaigning for the rights of all, right? We are committed to defying stereotypes, to redefining perspectives positively, to embracing acceptance and tolerance, to creating an active community. And I started this when I was like 13, I had no idea what I was doing. And we really grew to be something so profound that I'm so lucky to have been a part of. And three of our team members are right there, and they were a part of our work and a part of our growth and in really substantial ways. And I got to see just how powerful we can be and just how closely people are listening to us. When I started as a freshman, I had no conception of how far we could go. And suddenly I found myself at the White House, and I found myself meeting with the president, and I found myself meeting with industry leaders and sitting and speaking in rooms like this, where oftentimes I looked around and I was the only person under 30. And I thought to myself, right, what does this say about the worth that society and people of power are placing upon young people? Because one of two things happens if a group is not represented at the table. They're either assumed to not want to sit at the table, or they're assumed to be allowed to be spoken for. And neither of these two things are remotely permissible. And what I oftentimes reflect on is, if I couldn't make it to the meeting today, there would have been no young people here. My entire generation, right, these 22 million people, would have been entirely younger. Right? So if we tokenize and to say we're going to have one young person, that's enough, and then that person can't show up for whatever reason, that entire perspective is now nullified, is now completely erased, completely silenced. And that's what I'm talking about authentic engagement, right? Because we can't just be talking to one person and thinking that that's substantially sufficient. So that's why as I looked around these rooms, I looked around these conversations, and I thought about not only empowering people of color and minorities and people who experience different sexualities and gender on the gender spectrum, I thought about how to empower young people, because so many of us have no mechanisms to be heard in really profound ways in terms of meeting with industry leaders like you all. And so in my junior year, as a result of this, is working with so many incredible young people across such diverse spectrums. I created and founded, along with one of my friends here, Juv Consulting. And what Juv Consulting is we're a Generation Z marketing firm. And what we do is campaigns, companies, nonprofits come to us, and they want to understand how to market to Generation Z better, how to talk to us, what we're about. And we're nothing necessarily more than just a bunch of young people. We are a bunch of young people who want to talk to you. We are over 200 kids from around the world, or maybe it's more than that, maybe it's no better than I do. 600, he says. And he's the chief operations officer. And we're a lot of young people from around the world, and what we do is we have consultants, a core group of around maybe 150, and they have specific areas of expertise, right? Maybe it's athletics, maybe it's academics, maybe it's social justice, maybe it's leadership, maybe it's tech, maybe it's finance. And you come to us, and someone comes to us, and they say, we want to hear from young people. And then we pair together maybe a team of 10 of them with that client to really have a direct line of communication between young people and that business, or that campaign, or that messaging strategy, to cultivate a sense of understanding of Generation Z. Because we're not the focus group. We're not just going to sit around a table and be like, we like this, we don't like this. That's not substantive. That's not hearing from young people. That is a litmus test. And what we're seeing is that that's what people think is engagement, is doing research on Generation Z. They're youth experts. Like, why do you need experts when we exist in a three-dimensional world? Like, we can advocate for ourselves. And what we're doing is, we are saying, we don't need focus groups, we don't need research, just talk to us in real time. We can explain to you the pulse of what's happening. We can get you a diverse group across stratified regions that are representative of the diversity that exists within a generation. Generation Z is certainly not a monolith. Our trends are certainly not completely cohesive in any way, shape, or form, right? I'm completely aware, I want to set this conversation, the fact that I do speak from a Western perspective. I do speak from a privileged perspective as someone who goes to Yale, as someone who's from Princeton, New Jersey. And my perspective is not representative of all of these 22 million people. However, the only way that we'll even know that is by talking to maybe five of us and realizing we're not the same. And that's what I'm hoping to do, and that's what I hope to do with 3 to 5, with Juv Consulting, with all the work that I've done. And that's really brought me to a place where I've gotten really involved in political organizing and politically campaigning, and thinking about not only, right, how can I find ways to spread messages myself and to empower and pass the mic and use the mic effectively to amplify narratives that need to be heard, but also how can that be reflected in policy? And how can policy shape a progressive future that I want to live in, that I want to raise kids in one day? And as a result of that, I've been really fortunate to work on campaigns like Martin O'Malley's campaign, like Hillary Clinton's campaign, to work for the U.S. Department of State, to be a youth advisor to numerous political and non-governmental campaigns like this one. And as I find myself in those places, I just think about, right, that other idea I was alluding to. So I talked a little bit about what authentic engagement looks like. Right? It looks like talking to us. I'm not saying that me or Juv are necessarily the end-all, be-all solution at all. But I do think that we need to be on your board. We need to be having conversations with us. We need to be responding to our emails and bringing us in and hearing from us on a very consistent basis if you're interested truly in this idea. But more than that, in terms of exciting young people, right, what gets us ticked? What gets us a tick, right? What makes young people excited? When I think about why I was excited, right, in 2008, right, I think about the idea of agency. Because for me, yes, I'm excited by diverse progressivism. That isn't the case for all young people in America. But what is the case is that, if I'm talking in broad strokes, which I am skeptical of and wary of, I think young people are definitely drawn to bold ideas, right, to creative ideas, to difference, to things that challenge the status quo that make us believe that we can and we will. And as I think about that, as we think about 2020, we need to think about, are we going to keep on supporting candidates and parties and people who are just frankly boring? Because what we're seeing is that young people are not going to show up for boring. We're just not. We have no incentive to. Our parents will be boring enough and we don't have to engage with that. No, I love my parents, but
I
love my parents. But in terms of our parents will vote for that candidate, right? We don't feel like we have to do so much organizing to make them that much more establishment. Like, they already are establishment, right? They already have our parents' support. They don't need our help. Right? They don't need our agency in order to succeed. They're not going to excite us. And what I'm seeing, right, as I think about 2020, is I want a candidate who excites young people, right, who's different, who makes us think, you know what, like maybe our country can be on track. Maybe we do have a broken campaign finances, maybe we do have a broken democracy, maybe we do have a broken two-party system. Maybe our country is in shambles, but we still can in some regards. Our agency still matters. Right? There's still a chance for us to be heard, for us to be enfranchised, for us to have a seat at the table, in the same way that as a fourth grader Obama made me feel. And I think that there are candidates like that, and the only way that they're going to be able to capture our hearts and our minds, and it's important to know that 22 million is more than enough to sway an election, right? More than enough. And huge numbers, right? You see that map of what would the election look like if only millennials voted? Right? It's like 40 states are blue. Right? Don't quote me on that, but it looks like that if you look it up. And Generation Z is even more than that in some regards, right? So if we're thinking about these 22 million Generation Z voters, right? For me, right, I want the country to look blue. That might not be the same for all of you. I imagine it's for many of you, though we are in New York City. But regardless, I think that it's important to think about what's going to make the map look like that. that, right? What's going to make enough young people come out to sway an election one way or the other? And I think for me, that looks like engagement, that looks like being excited about something. And the last thing I'll talk about is information, right? What we're seeing right now in our digital era is algorithms are quite literally written and perpetuated to promote this idea of echo chambers, right? How can I ever change my mind? How can I ever engage with content or hope to become a voter when I wasn't a voter already, when everything in my feed is perfectly curated by an algorithm, things that they think I'll already like, right? And that's all the content that I'm ever going to engage with. Right now, almost every social media platform has shifted to algorithms in which I won't even see every post that my friends share. I'll only see the ones they think I'll want to engage with. And what we're finding is that you can use these tools and go on, like I downloaded this Chrome plugin, and 98% of my Facebook friends, Facebook predicts are liberal, which is a staggering statistic, right? And that means that not only are 98% liberal, but more likely than not, I'm only going to see their liberal content because of the algorithm, right? And these echo chambers mean that I'm going to be like really excited to vote because like my friends are political, I'm political. But if you're not, right, if you're just really into memes, or you're really into soccer, like that's the content that you're going to see. So how do we break into those audiences? We have to use tech really innovatively, right? We have to be able to advocate and lobby these groups to hopefully change that framework, to not care so much. To care about, obviously, monetization is important, and that's why it's been done. But impact is also important, right? Difference of opinion is also important. And disseminating diverse and accurate information is important, because this is the age of misinformation. People are calling the times we're living in post-truth. And the way that we center the conversation around what is true, around what we need to be focusing on, is by having outlets and mechanisms and ways to reach people authentically and directly. I think for me, that's really on Twitter in a lot of ways. I've been very active on Twitter. I love Twitter. It's where I get a lot of my information. But I think that tech really needs to be fundamental in this conversation of activating and exciting these 22 million voters, because a lot of us are online and a lot of us want to be seeing content that makes us excited, that makes us moved. Because ultimately, right, we want to be touched and we want to be moved, and we want to be motivated. And the way that we're going to do that is if companies, campaigns, you all, and many more beyond you, are not just interested in touching the minds and hearts of young people, but understanding them. But I think once we do that, and when we do that, this idea is really more than possible, and it's a future that I'm really excited about. So thank you all for being here, and I think there's some time for some questions.